I'm Xenia. I am raised a feminist. I have a family that was always very active, activists. And so I think I was always kind of a feminist and was very lucky to be raised in such an environment, which is why intergenerational feminism for me is a very important part. I studied law. I have a background in law, international and European law. Law was always a way, I would say, when I started this to create more justice. But of course, after a while, you realize when you're in law, especially with an international focus, there can be like the best laws, but that doesn't mean delay. It doesn't mean that it's also the factual situation. So how do societies change? And I think I gained an interest into how do you challenge power? How do you challenge systems of injustice, this feeling of injustice? So I moved more. I'm not working with the law itself now within the legal sector itself, though it's still an important background. But I also moved more into feminist leadership, transformative design, with this question, if law is not enough, how do we transform societies? And I guess the feminist movement building transform societies, systems, and what different levels of change do we need to address? What role does an individual play? How do we change societies? That became a more important question for me. And I'm a co-founder of Young Feminist Europe. I'm coming from grassroots activism as well. So this connections and movement building and with other young feminists, but also intergenerational is very important in my work.
My name is Martha Karua. I'm from Kenya. I'm a lawyer by training, and my background is in activism for women's rights, for expanded democratic space, for good governance, and generally for human rights. But when Xenia was giving us her background, I realized that though I cannot say I was raised in feminism, the stories that I heard from my paternal grandmother planted seeds of feminism in me. There were stories of defiance of custom in her time. When the word feminism was not in our lips, there was no women's movement, but her defiance, refusing to get married to the family appointed suitor and doing something considered an outrage, personally returning the animals that had been brought to her home, escorting them back to the would-be suitor's home. That really was an aberration of the time. And those stories and watching both my grandmother and my mother planted seeds of being responsible for myself, making my own choices, etc. And therefore, later day, in activism for democracy and rights, I realized that I was being treated differently in offices by judges when I go before them and in other spaces. And I became conscious that I was being treated differently because I was a woman. So my Damascus moment, as I call it, if you remember the Bible story of Paul on his way to Damascus, seeing the light. My Damascus moment came in a women's conference in Uganda. I went as a member of the International Federation of Women Lawyers, Kenya chapter, and I found an organized women's movement. And we came back to Kenya and reignited the women's movement. And I have thereafter, in all spaces that I occupied, utilized that space to further women's rights and human rights generally. I'm a politician, and I've been a politician for the last 30 years. I've been out of parliament for the last 10 years, but I remain a very active and engaged citizen while I wait to actualize the dream to introduce feminist leadership in my country. I was privileged to attend the Beijing conference in 1995. I was serving my first term as a member of parliament. And the most significant thing I would say of the 1995 Women's Conference in Beijing is that it came up with a comprehensive document agreed upon by member states on how to advance gender equality. The 12 critical areas of concern and all the commitments that were made in Beijing have stood us in good stead as advocates for gender equality, and they are the benchmarks with which countries are measured as to whether they have advanced in terms of women's rights. Also, that huge gathering of women reawakened the passion for fighting for gender equality across the world, really. Today's young feminists may not connect with the Beijing conference. And that's why intergenerational dialogue is so important, so that we can be able to transfer what we felt was the significance of the conference to the next generation, and also leave with them the commitment and the responsibility to drive the world towards gender equality.
The power also comes from having ownership about something, to be able to lead for something and to bring new ideas. And I think, especially in the Generation Equality Forum, it's important to review things and to see what are new approaches, because the Beijing Platform for Action has a very transformative approach and agenda. Mm-hmm. But what does it mean also in these times and in our context, and what do young people bring? So, for example, the question you posted was, how can young feminists participate? But we currently shift the language a little bit more to, how can young feminists lead, co-lead and co-own the spaces? Thank and how, and the importance for that is, I think we really, due to, of course, also technology, new technology, we really mobilize and organize across movements and borders. So, for example, the anti-racism movement or eco-feminist movement, it's not new to feminism, but I think this intersectional part of the movement is becoming even stronger and holistic to systems of oppression. And I do think not just asking for a seat at the table and participate in something and just increase diversity, we really push more also within the feminist movement sometimes to transform, to ask to do things differently. And I think that is important, to take ownership a little bit of the past process. Yeah, but I would love to hear from you. How was it then to organize and to have this, create this community?
It was pretty difficult because we had to attend physically meetings to interact with fellow women from different countries. Once in a while in East Africa, we could have a meeting that takes us to one country. And then after Beijing, we were able to keep attending at the UN, the Commission on the Status of Women, which again was an annual gathering of women. You share experiences from women from all over the world. And we would also take contacts and invite each other to meetings, especially within the African continent, within the East African region. It was not exactly easy, but we did meet and we used to energize each other. Even in Beijing itself, I remember meeting with the women from Zambia. They were going to have a workshop. We from Kenya, because I was already leading a women's political lobby, the League of Kenya Women Voters. So we met with the women's lobby from Zambia. We combined our workshops and held them together. So you can see, by meeting physically in a meeting, you start gaining allies and strategizing on how to work and re-energize each other. And I think that is why these spaces where feminists meet from all over the world are very important. We have learned a big lesson during Corona. We do not have to meet physically. Today we are having a meeting with you. It's virtual and it's as good as any. So now people are increasing the pace at which they interact without having to leave the comfort of their homes, without having to travel. And my hope is that young feminists are going to seize this opportunity, meet with each other across the globe, energize the movement, because it's always the youth that drive a revolution. We've done our bit. Some of us are old, but not tired. We are not even retired yet. We have matured. That's what I would say. The youth are the drivers of this movement today. And we really must let you be in the driver's seat. Those of us who have not completely left, we can only be co-drivers, but we cannot be at the driver's seat alone.
Even though we increase women in parliaments or in leadership positions, that does not necessarily mean that the systemic change will come. Of course, having increasing women in certain leadership positions and positions of power is a very can be a very effective tool, but it doesn't equal gender equality or achieving gender equality. And I think that's the very first, very important differentiation we need to make, is when we talk about feminist leadership, it's different than just female leadership. Because when we talk about female leadership and bringing more women in, that is an important tool, and that can have itself a transformative effect, but it doesn't guarantee a transformative effect. Feminist leadership, it's a different type of leadership. It's transformative leadership, and at the core is shifting power, challenging and shifting power, because if we want to achieve gender equality or equality overall, intersectional justice, that is always related to systems of inequality. So we have these systems of inequality. We need to develop the systemic thinking and see how power operates, understand power. Once you make power visible and understand it, you can change and shift it. And I think that's where what feminist leadership is about, but also challenging hierarchies and shared leadership. I think that's also something when you said co-driving, generations are co-driving or should be co-driving. I think that's one of the very key principles of feminist leadership. And I think this co-creation, co-designing, collaboration, co-learning, I think that is really, those are key principles for me when I talk about feminist leadership.
People are still afraid of calling themselves feminists because the reaction, especially of our male members of society, is as though being a feminist or the word feminism is a dirty word. We had an incident a week ago where radio presenters had made jokes about a victim of gender-based violence. It got wide condemnation and the presenters were suspended and the radio station fined by the regulator. The hashtag has been vilification of feminists, that toxic feminism, because they think it is a result of feminism that these people have been acted upon. I'm just saying that so that you see where we are as a society. But I'm very happy that there are young people, mainly young people, but also other ages, who are boldly calling themselves, putting themselves out there as feminists. And we are living in an age where celebrities like former President Obama, a world leader who is admired and respected by many, openly called himself a feminist. where the Pope has called himself a feminist. So this is a time to understand the term. But I want here to confess that initially, although in the rights movement, I feared calling myself a feminist. But maybe also my understanding of the terminology, I hadn't interacted with it well. And somewhere in the middle after Beijing, I was at peace calling myself a feminist, because really it just means somebody who is committed to gender equality. And women being the disadvantaged gender, it also can be described as somebody who is committed to women's equality and empowerment.
I also remember when I was in school and younger, and I was hesitant to call myself a feminist because of the wrong perceptions of what that means. I think people still have a misconception about feminism and see it as opposite to masculinity and that. But I think there is a change happening. And I also see that there is a lot of strength coming when you meet other people, other feminists who call themselves that, and you understand what it means, and that it's about standing up against systems of injustice and oppression and challenging current system.
The biggest challenge from where I sit is the lack of political will to drive the issue of gender equality by the leadership. In spite of the many commitments our country has made, in spite of the many international agreements our country is a signatory to, in spite of campaign promises by the party in power and by other political parties, you still see that there isn't genuine commitment towards driving the issue of equality. Leadership is comfortable with giving token positions and reluctant even to implement the constitution, which clearly sets us on a path to equality. The other challenge I see is lack of understanding by the women elected, their lack of commitment in driving the gender equality agenda. And that coupled with a parliament that is less sensitive. And I don't want to blame the women alone, because when we went to Beijing and thereafter continued on the path towards equality and passed a new constitution, maybe we wrongly assumed that the country was sensitized enough, because the constitution was voted for overwhelmingly with a Bill of Rights that is so woman-friendly and a constitution that is women-friendly. But maybe what we must always remember is that every so often there is a generational change. Every 10 years, even within parliament, the five-year cycle, because the rate of attrition is high, members entering parliament will not, the majority will not have been in the last. So there is a need to keep on sensitizing the new leadership, whichever arm of government, and to keep the issue of gender equality alive at all the times, so that we remind, sensitize ourselves and recommit.
I absolutely agree with that. And I think we also talked, of course, about the misconceptions about feminism, which is an obstacle. I think the gender binary is also still something that we need to move beyond this binary. And I think it's still difficult also when it comes to feminist leadership and within the feminist movement. And I think feminist movements are heavily underfunded. There's only, I think there were like from AVID these numbers that only 1% or not even 1% of all funding going towards gender equality programs are really going to feminist or women's movements. So this lack of funding of grassroots is really something that is an obstacle. From a young feminist perspective or intersectional feminist perspective, when we talk about feminist leadership, it's not just something where we push for change somewhere else, but when we take a look at this transformative approach, a lot of the work has to start within the self, within the relationships, within the institutions and organizations we are coming from. And I think we really need to take a look within the feminist movement as well and see how we also tend to perpetuate the same systems of oppression sometimes within the movement. It can, and that's where this intersectionality part, of course, comes in. I think decolonial approaches and anti-racism approaches are super important. And I think when it comes to feminist leadership, we sometimes forget that we need to start there and also take a look at our own relationship to power and powerlessness.
Violence against women, that's a key challenge, and it seems to be increasing, not decreasing, especially during COVID, when people, families have been together. This has increased and sometimes trapped the victims with the oppressor, and this is a real barrier and a challenge. Another area we have to look into is how we are bringing up our children and the next generation. Even if by law we gain equality in parliament and we have not gone there yet, so long as we are not nurturing our children to believe in gender equality and to practice it as a way of life, then we will have every other generation starting where we started. Therefore, for me, we should now start discussing about gender studies or gender relations beginning at the elementary school, so that the need to respect each other, irrespective of gender, we can start nurturing that in the young. And I believe once it is part of a school curricula, it will force us as a society in our families to discuss it as we discuss that schoolwork. So we are looking to having innovative ways of achieving the goals that were set in Beijing, the goals of equality. We cannot do it the same way we have done for the last 30 years and hope that all will be well. There has to be some change somewhere. And thank you for bringing up those issues, Xenia.
Can I ask you, do you think there are specific challenges for the feminist movement, or how do you bring, I guess that's been also a question, how do you bring the feminist movement, which is often understood as like coming from the grassroots or some, how do you bring it to the parliaments or to other stakeholders, and how are you connecting these for you?
Thank you for that. It's us working with everyone and sensitizing people who are in different, occupy different spaces of power and decision-making, because we need them. We need their voices and sometimes their votes to move this agenda. So continuous engagements, that's what I was referring to, because we have a disconnect. During my time, the last parliament I served, which was the 12th parliament in Kenya, the 10th rather, we had sensitized members so well that even when we passed the constitution, we all embraced the agenda. There were very few people not committed to the agenda. When the 11th parliament came, it's like everybody assumed parliament is sensitive, not remembering that that's a new lot that has come in. There is also intergenerational change in the leadership in many aspects. So if we key in our minds that this has to be continuous engagement in all the spaces we occupy, in our homes, because we are raising children, some will have become adults, others will be in teenage. So this has to be a continuous thing. And especially if it gets to the curriculum, then we will be able to do it. But I have found that a parliament is as sensitive as the work done by those who are rooting, either for human rights or for gender equality or for whatever other purpose. So we have to commit ourselves to be internal lobbyists for gender equality. Yeah.
In relation, for example, for feminist leadership, there is this one story that I found very interesting. I think it comes actually from the African feminist or women's movement, is where you had this big gathering of women and feminists to this conference. And then there were a lot of conflicts and disagreements sparking. But instead of just staying with that, I think out of that came feminist principles for the African movement. And I thought that was very interesting because, of course, there are so many different ways to do feminism. I mean, also currently, I'm super excited to see what we are doing with the Generation Equality Forum, the Young Feminist Manifesto, having all these different types of young feminists coming together, occupying space, stepping up into leadership, challenging power.
Like you, I would cite the network building and solidarity building of women across the world in commitment to the Beijing Platform for Action. And before Corona, the annual pilgrimage to New York every year was like equal almost to a religious festival, where feminists from all over the world go to re-energize and to share. It gives me the passion to continue, because if we leave the movement at a time we are broken and not as solid as we were before, then we are not passing on the skills of telling each other that, yes, we are not homogeneous, but there are things that bind us together. So solidarity building and network building are the most exciting things that are found in the feminist movement. One of the things we really must learn and accept is that learning is a two-way process. As a senior or older feminists, by listening to those who come after me, there is something I will learn. And when they also listen to me, there is a takeaway. So knowledge sharing across the generations is an important tool to build our solidarity as feminists. And even if we are all using the Beijing Platform for Action as a reference point, methods of how to achieve those commitments vary from generation to generation. And I find that the young are coming with new innovative ideas that will prepare us to move forward. And I think that failing to have intergenerational dialogue would bring the death or the decline of feminism.
You're taking the words out of my mouth. I think I couldn't agree more. And I think having these knowledge sharing and that it goes both ways is such an important point that you're making. On the one hand, we do not have to reinvent the wheel, and we really, there's so much knowledge in the generations that we can tap into. And of course, it's also like we need to give room to innovations and to doing things differently and doing things new. So I agree with you there. Maybe to add, and something that we have done, for example, in the Generation Equality Forum with the Young Feminist Manifesto, part of it is also taking a look at power also. And I think power, which is key to feminist leadership and understanding and analyzing it, also exists between the generations. That's an experience that a lot of young feminists make, is really coming into a space and being really low in the hierarchies. So there are hierarchies within women's organizations, feminist movements, and you often come in and are not able to shape or to do anything. So there are these power imbalances. And I think the first thing to do between feminist generations or coming together in these spaces is really being aware of this imbalance and how can I myself, can we ourselves challenge and shift this power within that exists between the different generations.
Core ownership and core driving literally means that the power must be shared and power must be seen as a shared space for the intergenerational dialogues. Otherwise, if as older women or feminists, we take all the leadership positions and relegate the young to the periphery, then that's not meaningful dialogue. And that's not even a transfer of skills. So we really must make sure that all generations have a space at the decision-making table, not at the periphery.